that don't move you, I don't know what will.
Amen.
Yep. Are you washed in that blood?
Amen.
We're all.
Going to Galatians this morning. Galatians chapter 1. Galatians chapter 1. Galatians chapter 1 and verse 10. Galatians 1, verse 10. Paul writes, For am I now seeking the approval of men or of God? Or am I trying to please men? For if I were still trying to please men, I would not be the servant of Christ. Who will you please? Who are you out to please?
God.
Are you out to please God?
Amen.
Or are you out to please men? You can't please both. I want us to consider this morning briefly. I want us to go back in history and consider the rise of Nazi Germany. And we need to understand, as Nazi Germany arose, within that nation there was a confessing church, and then there was the German church. The German church was the religious arm of the fascist Nazi socialist movement. The confessing church was a church that stood on the Word of God in opposition to the Nazi movement, as well as in opposition to the German church. And between the years of 1933 to 1945, there were some 18,000 pastors in Germany. And of those 18,000 professing Christian pastors, only 5,000 of that 18,000 stood with the true church, the confessing church of that day in Germany. The other 13,000 stood with Hitler and his fascist socialistic government. In other words, that remnant in Germany during the days of the Nazi regime, that remnant, that confessing church, was a church who stood for the truth, and they were only a remnant. They were a minority in the nation. And so as we look back to that historical time, we can see that an overwhelming majority chose to bow and to conform both to political as well as social pressure. That's what happens when, in Southern vernacular, we would say, when push comes to shove. Or we might say, that's what happens when the rubber meets the road. When it's going to cost you something to serve God, then you are going to make a decision to go on with God or to go on with the world. Many within the professing ranks of Christianity have begun to allow the norms of our culture. Many in our nation today are beginning to bend and to bow to the political and social pressures of our day.
True, true, true.
The same thing can be seen happening in this nation that happened in Nazi Germany, folks. You say, how far are we going to reach it? I don't know. I desire and pray for a great revival to turn the tide back that we're facing. But at what seems to be an alarming, increasing rate in our nation, there seems to be a great attack on our religious liberties. And in that attack, what we are seeing within the professing church is we're seeing this great divide developing between the true church in our nation, between that remnant of faithful in our nation and a compromising church that is growing daily. The divide is not denominational.
Right.
The divide or the division is an issue of loyalty and fidelity to the Word of God. We're either going to stand with this book or we're going to find ourselves standing against it. I've decided which way I'm going.
We have to.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
More and more professing believers in our nation are compromising biblical values, compromising biblical standards, compromising biblical principles. In John chapter 12 and verse 43, John gives us an illustration, or he describes adequately this spirit that was somewhat prevalent in his day that we see arising and surfacing in our nation. John 12 and 43, John writes, "For they loved the praise of men more than the praise of God." Notice the context here in Galatians, in our scripture, in our text this morning. The context of this scripture is that Paul is addressing the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And his concern in writing this letter to the Galatians, he is concerned with those in the church of Galatia that have turned from the truth. They have turned to another message. They have turned to another gospel. And in doing so, they have turned to another God. They've turned to a false gospel, another gospel, a false message that purports to be a true message. Now, what we need to understand is this: the preaching of the gospel is not pleasant to the lost man's ear.
That's true.
It's just not. And God's word says that no man can please both God and man at the same time. And so that tells me that if I preach the gospel, there are going to be times when I disturb folk. It tells me that if you and I live the gospel, there are going to be times when we make man very angry with us. Do you understand that Christians are already being persecuted? Not only persecuted, but prosecuted by the law in this nation simply for standing on the truth. There are ministers of the gospel in the United States of America within the past 3 months who have been prosecuted for refusing to perform homosexual weddings. There are Christians in this nation who have been prosecuted because they refused to take pictures at a homosexual wedding, or they refused to make a cake endorsing a homosexual marriage. Now that's fact in the United States of America. And what I'm saying to you folks is this is only the beginning.
Start. Exactly.
This is just the tip of the iceberg. We're going to look at several issues this morning which will explain to us this divide that is taking place between the true church, between the remnant of true Christians in our nation, and the ever-growing compromising church that is growing at a rapid and alarming rate. Jesus told his disciples that the day would come when those who killed them thought that they would be doing God a favor. The compromising church of our day can be defined as an apostate church. And God's word gives us great warning of what the last days would be like before he returned. He said it would be inhabited by an apostate people. Paul, writing to Timothy, said that day would be illustrated or demonstrated where many within the church would give heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils.
Forbidding to marry.
When you read the revelation of Jesus Christ in the last letter of this book, you will discover that there is a woman in Revelation that is described as a great harlot. This great harlot is a religious unification of all religions that have come together around the world, and they will be in bed with the Antichrist. Do you understand that some of the greatest preachers, or some of the best, I won't say greatest, some of the best known preachers in our nation, even Baptists, are working diligently right now with Muslims and Catholics and Hindus and all the religions of the world, saying that it's time for us to come and become one in Christ. I saw where a school the other day has literally replaced the Pledge of Allegiance with Allah instead of God. That's where we're at, folks.
That's sad.
It is currently on the rise around the world, and it is beginning to show its ugly face in our nation. And so the main thing I want us to leave here understanding this morning is this. The desire of God's people should be to please God.
Amen.
That's why we're here. We are here to please God. We are here to glorify God. We are here to obey God. We are here to speak forth the Word of God. And so the main point is this. The desire of God's true people is to please God. If your desire is not to please God, then you need to take Paul's advice and examine yourself to see whether or not you're really in the faith. So the first thing I want us to see is this. We must serve Christ, not the culture that surrounds us. We must serve Christ, not the culture of the world. Now, the true church, the remnant church, will set forth Jesus Christ above the culture.
Exactly.
The true church will seek to reflect and to display Christ to this world. The true church will refuse to compromise biblical morality.
Amen.
The true church will not be tossed to and fro with every wind and wave of doctrine. The true church will not bend and bow and forsake the truth in order to conform to the world. We are not here to please the culture. We're not here to please man. We are here to please God.
Amen.
Amen.
On the other hand, if we look at the compromising church of our day, we will see that what the compromising church is seeking to do is to accommodate the world. In other words, they dare not speak the truth and rock the boat. They dare not say anything that will offend anyone. Offending folk is rapidly becoming hate speech today. You can offend anybody. You can't offend anybody anymore in our nation unless it's a Christian. It's all right to offend a Christian.
Amen.
It's all right to step all over and trample a Christian's rights. That's the compromising church. It's a part of that, folks. They refuse to rock the boat. They go along with the world because they have given in and they are being conformed to the world rather than being transformed and conformed into the image and the likeness of Christ. Their message is shaped by the world that we live in, not by the Word of God. Jesus said, you better watch out when men start speaking well of you. You see, the compromising church is serving and pleasing the world, not Christ. We must serve Christ, not the culture that surrounds us. The desire of God's true people is to please God. Second thing, you've got to hurry this morning. We must stand on the Word of God despite the opposition.
Amen.
We must stand on the Word of God despite opposition. You see, the true church has made the Word of God her standard. This is our standard. And anything that disagrees with this book or contradicts this book is beneath it. It's a wrong standard. It's an illegitimate standard. How long do you think it's going to be before it becomes illegal for a preacher to preach and to proclaim the whole counsel of God from pulpits in this nation?
It's not very long.
Oh, come on now, preacher. You can't really believe that. Folks, I have watched over the past 35 years the progression. And I've seen that spirit of hatred in our government and in the media and in our culture becoming more and more hostile toward the truth of God's Word. I see it every day. Our culture defining certain scriptures in this book as being hate speech. The true church will not bend and bow to accommodate their disdain and their displeasure.
Amen.
But the compromising church is a church that says, you need to pipe it down, preacher. You need to pipe it down, church. You need to be more tolerant of sin.
No.
Don't hurt your feelings.
You see, what the compromising church of our day is doing is they are changing their theology to conform to the ways of the world. You'll never hear them becoming involved in controversy. You'll never hear them take a stand against sin. You'll never hear them proclaim that old-fashioned message that says Jesus Christ is the only way, and if you get in, that's the only way you're going to get in. The compromising church of our day will say there are many paths to God. There are many ways to get in. Jesus Christ says that way is a broad way, and it's a lie that leads to destruction, and many are headed in that direction. They will adhere to a false gospel, a gospel of their own making. Because the God that they have conjured up in their mind is tolerant, loving, and would never say or do anything that is remotely judgmental. We must stand on the Word of God despite all opposition. The desire of God's true people is to please Him. Third, quickly this morning, we must place the kingdom of God above our culture. Jesus said, seek after the kingdom of God and His righteousness first. Number one.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Seeking the kingdom of God and His righteousness. Mm-hmm. God's kingdom is eternal. Man's kingdom is short-lived. Man's kingdoms are temporary. Man is in a quest today to build a perfect world because God has failed. Man, in his stinky thinking, somehow believes that God has appointed him to do his building of a kingdom. You know, that's what every leader, political leader around the world seeks to do, is build his own kingdom. Wishes to do it his own way.